With that, let's open our Bibles this morning to the book of 2 Corinthians. We are not done talking about the resurrection and the effect that it's going to have. We're going to take a look at that this morning on what it should have, particularly on our attitude and mindset. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I might just say that the Apostle Paul does not shy away from our future that we have in Christ. So in chapter 5, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning in verse 1, "For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved," and what's he talking about? He's talking about physical death. "Well, we know that if and when that happens, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tabernacle," added, "we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven." And that house that Paul is referring to is that new body that we're looking at in 1 Corinthians 15. "If so be," verse 3, "that being clothed we shall not be found naked." One of the interesting things is, I know you're thinking this is scripture reading time, so cut the commentary, but let me just say this, that the complete person is body, soul, and spirit. Three parts. And we're going to have a body someday. And while absent from the body is present with the Lord, what's happening? What's happening to those spirits in heaven right now? They are waiting to be clothed upon with this house that Paul is talking about. Verse 4, "For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed," or not that we would die, "but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore, we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Wherefore we labor, that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Let's pause for prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just again want to thank you for your love that you bestowed upon us. We thank you that your love motivated you to pay the ultimate price to secure our salvation. We thank you that our sins have been paid for, that you are more than willing to forgive anyone who will simply trust in you. And so we thank you for that. We thank you for the gift of eternal life. And so as we think of meeting here this morning, we want to thank you for our country. We thank you for the freedoms that we enjoy. We thank you that we can open the Bible without fear. And we just pray for those brothers and sisters in Christ around the world who don't have this privilege, who are being persecuted and are suffering and even some dying because they name the name of Christ. We just pray that your grace would sustain them and that their courage could be a good example to the rest of us who maybe in the short future will be facing the same type of persecution. We pray that we would have courage to stand and to not be moved. And so we pray to that end. We want to remember those who are suffering physically. We commit each one to you. We know that you have a purpose for every life. And we just pray that whether we're feeling good this morning or not so good, that we would understand that you want us in our situations to bring honor and glory to the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we commit this morning to you, this service. We pray that it would be an encouraging time and also just a time when we can be refreshed and reminded of the great things we have given to us by your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to 1 Corinthians, just a few pages to the left of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, what we read this morning. to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And as we consider this subject that we're in, I don't know if I've told you this, but for me, this is really an exciting subject. And we have something to look forward to. And I would just say this, the older you get, the more exciting this should be. And so as we think of the ancient world that Paul was in, and those in Greece, the Greeks especially, were philosophers. And they had developed the idea that there is no resurrection of the dead. That when you die like a dog, and there is no future. That's it. And so the philosophy is that all we worry about is the spirit world, but as far as the physical body is concerned, and there were trains of thought that came out of that. One was the Stoic, where you needed to punish your body and deprive it, and the other was the other extreme, eat, drink, and be merry, because you're going to die anyway. And so the Apostle Paul, this philosophy had crept into the church, and there were those who were believers who were questioning whether or not we would be resurrected. And so Paul takes the time to prove the resurrection. And of course, he does that right in the beginning with the gospel. He said Christ died. In fact, if you look with me at verse 3, he says, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. And then he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and then he was seen." And so he gives an eyewitness account of the resurrected Savior all the way through verse 10. And so the Apostle Paul, the last one to see the risen Christ, and he was the last one to see him, and he saw him actually after the ascension. Jesus Christ appeared to the Apostle Paul. We don't know exactly where that happened, but my good guess is this, is that after Paul got saved, he spent 3 years in the wilderness outside Damascus with the Lord Jesus Christ, as God himself taught Paul about the mystery of the church. And so the Apostle Paul is the great apostle that explains to us like no other what the body of Christ is all about. In fact, in the scripture, it's called a mystery. Now, a mystery is not something that's ooh, it's something that is simply not been explained in the Old Testament. So if you want to learn about the church today, you don't learn that from the Old Testament. There's plenty to learn from the Old Testament, but not that. And then there's something else in the Old Testament that, and while there were people who were caught up, there was something else that was a mystery, and the Apostle Paul reveals that in this chapter right here. So there's two questions that came up, and these questions are in verse 35 of chapter 15. How are the dead raised, and what kind of body will the raised have? And so Paul uses nature to illustrate that in verses 36 through 41. And then he uses the scripture, creation, to illustrate how the resurrection will work. And so what we did, and I'll just very briefly kind of review, when a body right now, our body, this is a description of them, how it's going to be planted and how it's going to be raised. And Paul has already made the point, and we made the point last week, that when you drop a seed into the ground, what comes out? What grows out? Oh, just another seed, right? No, something glorious, more glorious than what you put in the ground. And the Apostle Paul wants to make that point. And so how is it planted? He describes it's perishable. That means it's subject to decay. How is it going to be raised? It's going to be raised imperishable. It's never going to decay. It's going to be sown in dishonor, shame, disgrace. It's going to be sown in weakness. Weakness means fragile, easily broken. And it's going to be raised in honor, splendor, brightness. And I just mentioned, because some of us are familiar with the word doxology, this is where that comes from. Doxa, it means to give honor. It's going to be raised in strength. And I might just say that that little word weakness and strength, I think last week I read through it and I missed it. So I'll just make a comment right now about it. We are fragile. And if you haven't noticed that, the older you get, let's put it this way. If you are a little 2 or 3 year old and you broke a bone, they heal pretty fast and they heal pretty well. If you're here and you're over 80 and you break a bone, it takes a long time to heal. And your bones break easier as you get older. Why? Because we are naturally very fragile. In fact, I might say life itself is fragile. We have no guarantee on life tomorrow. But it's going to be raised, and the King James says strength in strength. It's the opposite of weakness. It's not fragile. It's something that's unbreakable. And you almost have to think about that for a little bit. Imagine having a body that is unbreakable. It's hard for us to fathom that. It's sown a natural body, and the first man, Adam, he was called a living soul, but it's going to be raised a spiritual body, and the last Adam is a life-giving spirit. And so as we just think of what sustains life, in heaven is going to be different than what sustains life here on this earth. And exactly what those bodies are going to look like, I'm not sure. I've never been to heaven. I don't have my glorified body. This fragile body right here is, I just heard my own neck crack. Okay, it's falling apart. And the truth of the matter is, the moment we begin to live, we begin to die. And for some, that's going to come sooner than others, but it is going to happen. And this is a great question. What happens after death? And so Paul wraps it up and makes some conclusions, and he has this to say. And the original question here focused on those who died. And this is kind of interesting because in 1 Thessalonians, the Apostle Paul teaches about the coming of the Lord and being caught up to meet him in the air. And those people asked, and they weren't being cynical, they just had a real question. And Paul says, I don't want you to be ignorant about that. And he shows, and their question was, well, what happens to the dead? And he says, they're not disadvantaged at all. They're going to be raised first, in fact. And we'll try to illustrate that in just a moment. But then the Apostle Paul, in talking about the dead and their resurrection in this chapter, he throws in the fact that when Jesus Christ returns, not every Christian is going to have died physically. There's going to be Okay, ready for this? Some of us will be alive at his coming. I hope, wouldn't that be something? If we could skip the undertaker. There aren't any undertakers here this morning. We're not trying to cheat you or anything, but I'll tell you this. When Jesus Christ returns, and all those who are in Christ, guess what? You're not getting their business, because the Apostle Paul explains exactly what's going to happen. And so his main point is this. He says in verse 50, "Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot enter the kingdom of God." And his point is simply this. Well, we know that the dead, their dead bodies can't enter the kingdom. It's going to have to be changed. But there's another point, and that is your live body can't enter the kingdom. It's going to have to be changed as well. We are simply not compatible for heavenly living in this particular body. And so, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. And that would be the first part of that verse is in reference to those saints, those Christians, those believers, and that's who he's talking to in this passage. He's saying, listen, you're not equipped the way you are, and neither are those who have died. And then he says in verse 51, "Behold, I show you a mystery." Now, a mystery, as I just mentioned, is something that has not been explained in the Old Testament. And that is the catching away of the church. Jesus Christ could come back at any moment and catch us away. And as we think of that catching away that's going to happen, it could happen today. And here's what he says, "We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed." We all need a new body, whether you die before he comes back or if he comes back before you die and you cheat death. If that's the way it is, it doesn't matter. We all need to be changed. And as we think about that that changing right there, with this question here. How's this going to happen? And he tells us when it's going to happen. It's going to happen earlier in the chapter, he explains. It's going to happen when he returns. Now, your question is, well, when is he going to return? And here is the answer. Only God the Father knows. In fact, what he told us is this. That's none of your business. When I return, I'm not going to tell you when I'm going to return, but I am going to return, and I want you to be ready. Are you ready for his return? Well, I'd like to know when he's coming so I can get the house cleaned up before he comes. Isn't that true? Ladies, if you're having... I know this would happen to me. If I invited somebody over, Brenda would say, "Well, why didn't you tell me so I could be prepared?" And I know she's not the only one. It's nice to know ahead of time when you're going to have company. It's nice to know ahead of time. Agreed? And God says, "You know what? I'm coming, but I'm not going to tell you when. But I want you to be ready." And this is what Paul was driving at in 2 Corinthians 5 when he says, "We walk by faith, not by sight." And so every day that we live, we should be looking forward to the coming of the Lord. It's interesting that the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 4 says, "We who are alive and remain." The Apostle Paul anticipated the coming of the Lord before he died. You know what? He died. That was 2,000 years ago. We are 2,000 years closer. I don't know when he's coming, but if the Apostle Paul was anticipating the return of Christ, we should live with that same anticipation. Well, we read on, and we say, well, how is this going to happen? In verse 52, if you're here and... Okay, very good. Okay, if we're here and we you believe in evolution that takes millions and millions of years, look at verse 52 very carefully. He says this, but we shall all be changed. How shall that change come? In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. It does not say we're going to evolve into this change over the next million years. Listen, when God does something, he can do it right now. He created the whole world in 6 days and all the life that is in it in 6 days. In fact, on the sixth day, he made all the animals, all the mammals that are walking around. And on the same day, he made Adam and man. And you know what? He didn't need millions and millions of years to do it. This change is going to happen in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Just as a joke, I heard people that from New York City, and they defined a twinkling of an eye as the time it takes for the red light at a red light to turn green and horns to start blowing if you don't get going. Apparently, they're pretty impatient there. I don't know, but it's going to be quicker than that, believe me. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. This is great news. And then he goes on to say, because, and that little word for there in verse 53, for this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. And then in verse 55, the Apostle Paul asks two rhetorical questions. One, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Now in this life, death does have a little sting to it. And for any of you who've had a close relative die, parents, a spouse, a child, it stings. It hurts. But in the long run is what he's talking about. That sting is something that we don't have to worry about. So the question, where is death's sting? Where is the grave's victory? And he goes on and he says this in verse 56, the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. And so as we think of that first Adam that came into the world, we're told very clearly in Romans chapter 5, we won't turn there, but it says, by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. It's through Adam that death has entered into the world. And if you're here and you're a human being, you are subject to death because of sin. And you say, well, how do I know I'm a sinner? The law tells us that. In fact, if we really took a good look at the law, the righteous standards of the law, it is given to prove that we are sinners. And if there's anyone here who thinks that they can keep God's law perfectly, they are delusional. The strength of sin is the law. And so as we stop and ask those questions, I wrote Hebrews 2:15, and let's just take a moment to look at Hebrews 2:15. It's towards the back of the Bible. And in Hebrews 2:15, the author makes a very interesting comment. And he says this in verse 14, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood," and so that's natural people, "he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that hath the power of death, that is the devil." Now look at verse 15. "And deliver them." Well, that's one of the themes of the Bible, isn't it? Deliverance, salvation. "And deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." And as we stop and we think about that verse, what the author is saying is that there is something about death that scares us. Now, I know when you're young, you don't think about it. But I'll tell you what, death is not a pleasant thought. We like to push it out of our thinking. And young people, they know probably nothing about death or are not afraid of anything like that. But there is a fear that's built into every one of us. And it's through Jesus Christ that we can be delivered from that, because Satan has been defeated, verse 14. And what a little passage of Scripture that we have, that we don't have to fear death. And so we go back to 1 Corinthians 15, and the question, "O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory?" I'll tell you this. If Jesus Christ had never come, had never died for us, for our sin and paid the penalty, was never resurrected, I'll tell you what, you better be afraid of death. You better do all you can to stay alive, because what a sting that will be. And the grave will be the victor. But here the Apostle Paul asks the question, "O grave, where is thy victory?" But then look at verse 57. "But thanks be to God, which has given us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." And it's interesting where he says, "O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory?" It's not the grave's victory. It's the victory that Christ gives us over death, hell, and the grave, that we can be thankful for. And so I kind of put together a little picture right here that might help us visually see this. And here in Adam, all die. That's not only stated in Romans 5, but it's stated earlier in this chapter, in 1 Corinthians 15, that in Adam, all die, but in Christ, all live. And how does a person get into Christ? And the Bible tells us, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved." And don't add to that. Don't subtract from that. Don't add to that. Just take what the text says at face value. And so, John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." It's almost a commentary on itself, isn't it? The Word of God means something, and let's take it at face value. So when a person places their faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ, they are given forgiveness of sins. They're given eternal life. And I kind of pictured this but we're still on the road of life. We still have to drive on through all the potholes around town. Boy, they're terrible, aren't they? We still have to go through all of that, but and we still have a spirit, soul, and body, and we're walking along, but sometimes things happen. And what can happen? We can die. And that's exactly what Paul is talking about in both 1 Thessalonians 4 and in 1 Corinthians 15. Death comes along, and we're planted. And what happens? Our soul and spirit goes to be with Jesus Christ in heaven. And it tells us, so will we ever be with him. And that's very interesting. If we take the Bible literally, what that means is there's never going to be a time when we will be separated from our Savior forever and ever and ever. And that is good news for us. Well, as the Apostle Paul explains, and we have in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. In fact, you can do this. Keep your left hand in 1 Corinthians 15 and turn over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And here is what the Apostle Paul has to say in verse 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep. The word asleep is in reference to believers who have physically died, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. Now, he's not saying you can't sorrow. What he's saying is you don't have to sorrow hopelessly. We sorrow, but there's a hope. And those outside of Christ have no hope. Verse 14, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain. Notice Paul said, we which are alive and remain. He was anticipating the return of Jesus Christ in his lifetime. We should too. Those of us which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not precede them which are asleep. And the idea is that those who have died first have no disadvantage over those who haven't died at the return of Christ. Verse 16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And so, it's interesting. At the end of verse 14, Paul says this, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. And so let me put that again. Now, I'm not an artist, but you have to picture. Those souls and spirits of the dead are coming back with him. Will forever be with the Lord. Your soul and spirit, when you die and it goes to heaven and you'll forever be in the presence of the Lord, wherever the Lord goes, you're going to go with him. And when he comes to earth, you're coming with him. And what's going to happen? What's going to happen is the dead in Christ will be raised and their bodies will be changed. And so I made that a different color. Remember, Paul described this as earthy? That's us. We're earthy. But this guy is heavenly. And he's got a new body. And he is going to be raised first, and then at the same time, we're going to be caught up together and meet him in the air, and we'll all be changed. This dead body, not compatible with heaven. This living body, not compatible with heaven. They're all going to be changed when Jesus Christ returns. And we're going to have a brand new body in Christ. And so and then we're going to proceed to our new home in heaven. Remember what Jesus said in John 14? Let not your hearts be troubled. Then he says, I go to my Father's house to prepare a place for you. And if I go there to prepare a place for you, and when did he go? Well, at the ascension. He went up to heaven, and he prepared a place for us in heaven. And he says, if I go to prepare a place for you, and I might just say, what God does, he doesn't undo. He's not going to say, ooh, I prepared a place for you, but I lost your reservation, so I'm sorry you can't come. Oh, no. If he's going to heaven to prepare a place for you, he is going to come back and get you and put you in that place. And that's exactly what he's telling us in John chapter 14. So before Jesus comes, what did we have? We had a perishable body. After he comes, that body is going to be turned into imperishable. It was sown in dishonor. It's going to be honorable. It was weak. And we noted that word weak there means fragile. We are fragile. I already mentioned that. It's not going to be fragile. It's going to be unbreakable after. We're mortal. But there's a day coming when our mortality will put on immortality. Now, a body that's described like that, I'll tell you what, use your imagination. This is amazing. This is amazing. But I want you to know something about our God, our Creator God in heaven. When he does something, it is amazing. In fact, even our earthly bodies are wonderfully made. Your body right now is a work of art, even though it's under the curse of sin. Even though it's fragile, it is an amazing piece of machinery. Let me tell you this. We were created in God's image. And God knows everything. We don't know everything, that's for sure. But we have the ability that animals don't have to think and reason. Now, I know there's a lot of talk about artificial intelligence taking over. But listen, I don't care how smart Elon Musk is or anyone else. He's not smarter than God, and he will never, ever duplicate what God has duplicated in us in his creative work. Life comes from God, and that's what we have. And so as we make our way back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we have, this all should have an effect on us. And the first thing that Paul mentions here at the end of the chapter is thankfulness. Thanks be to God. He is the one who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, victory over hell, death, and the grave does not come from us. It does not come from a denomination. It does not come from a particular church. It comes directly from God himself. And what should our mindset be? Thank you. Thank you. Thanks. Is one of those characteristics that's mentioned throughout the scripture. Some people think, well, boy, there's a real spiritual guy. There's a real man of faith. You know, one of the manifestations of a real spiritual guy is thankfulness. It's thankfulness. I sometimes have to check myself in that area because I don't know about you, but I just kind of like to gripe. I mean, I gripe about all kinds of things. Even it's just fun. And but I'm a real spiritual guy. Oh yeah, right. Okay, but thanks to God, who is the one who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then he goes on in the last verse and says, therefore, and the therefore could be translated, because of all I just told you, there should be an outcome. And so here we are. And in Romans chapter 8, verse 29, we're told that we are predestined. Now this verse is for believers. And listen, if you're in Christ this morning, you are going to be conformed to the image of God's Son. That's God's plan for you. It's interesting that God will let us, allow us in this life to be a little bit conformed, but I'll tell you what, it's nothing like what's going to, the transformation that's going to take place in heaven. And so to kind of illustrate that, turn with me, if you would, to 1 John. 1 John is in the back of the New Testament. I think Revelation, then Jude, then 3 John, 2 John, 1 John. 1 John chapter 3. And I'll pick it up in verse 1. And it's interesting because of all the books that John wrote, he wrote them when he was an old man. And there's one thing you got to appreciate about old men. They sometimes just kind of tell it like it is, and they don't care. Okay? And this is what's coming out of John. He's telling it like it is. And earlier in the chapter, he says, you know what? You guys think you're so spiritual and you don't love your brother. You're a liar. I mean, he just lays it on the line. I would be afraid to call anyone a liar now, but when I'm as old as John was, he did it. He didn't mince words. And he says this, behold, in verse 1, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. What manner of love? You can be in the family of God. And then he says this, beloved, now are we the sons of God. I want you to get that little word now right there. When are we the sons of God? Sometime in the future? Sometime in the past? No, right now. Right now, you are in the family of God. We're children of God. Now, look at the next phrase. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Boy, that kind of sounds like 1 Corinthians 15, doesn't it? And so as we think of our future, our hope, in the second half of that little verse, we're going to be just like Jesus Christ. You know what Paul just told us in Romans 8? Well, that was God's plan for you all along. You're going to be conformed to the image of his Son. John just tells us when that transformation is going to be complete, when he comes. And so, but the passage doesn't end there. It says this, and every man, look at verse 3 carefully, and every man that hath this hope in him purifies himself. And so we will be like Jesus Christ. Is that exciting? It should be. And in 1 John 3:3, that whole mindset, knowing this, beholding, getting a hold of our future in Christ should have an effect on how we live today. It should affect our thinking. And as we stop and we think of what that means for us, let's go back to 1 Corinthians 15 and look at the last verse of that chapter. Now, this should be the effect of this information. You know, it'd be interesting. And oftentimes, young people, this is a good question to ask at times. So what? We're going to be resurrected. We're going to be like Christ someday in the future. Well, so what? Well, here's the so what. Here's the answer to that right here. Therefore, because of all this that I just told you, my beloved brethren, he's talking to Christians now, and he says this, be steadfast, unmovable. And that had special meaning in that day because they were being bombarded with false doctrine, false teaching. And as we stop and think of that, back in verse 33, he says, be not deceived, evil communications corrupt good manners. And that might be a little poor translation, but as we stop and we think of the effect that wrong doctrine has on you, listen, don't be moved. There's going to be all kinds of baloney, nonsense that is being spewed out. And then he goes on to say, abounding, always abounding in the work of the Lord. And the idea of abounding there is this. You're willing to go the extra mile for the Lord. It's kind of interesting. When it comes to tithing. Did you know that everything you have, including your time, belongs to God? Oh no, not me. 10% of my time belongs to God, 90% belongs to me. Oh no, oh no. You've been bought with a price, you're not your own. 100% of you belongs to God. Are you with me? Now, I'm not saying you should put 100% of all you got in the offering plate, that's not the point at all. The point is, this is a mindset. This is an attitude that there are things that need to be done for Jesus Christ. And he goes on to say this, knowing, and that word knowing is a important word. Because you see, if you don't know what your future is, you're not sure about your future, or worse yet, your future is dependent upon your works, then how do you know if you're working in vain? Oftentimes you get this answer or this question. You know you're going to heaven? Yeah, I know that. Oh, you must think you're pretty good. No, I don't think I'm pretty good. In fact, I'm pretty bad. Well, how can you know? You see, if a person believes that their good works get them to heaven, and they say, I know I'm going to heaven, then they're saying their good works must be good enough. Are they? I hope so. Can never be sure. I mean, there's some big-time Bible teachers that claim they're only 99% sure they're going to heaven. Really? I want you to know that there are some for sure things in the Scripture. And because of those for sure things, because we have a home in heaven, because we are going to be like Christ someday. We're going to have a brand new body that's going to serve him forever and ever and ever. That is unbelievable. But believe it, because it's true and we can know it. And he says this, as for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Earlier in this passage, the Apostle Paul says, I labored more abundantly than they all. And I want you to know that the grace that God bestowed upon me was not in vain. It's not empty. What you do for Christ, it will last. And that's very important. We read this morning in our scripture reading. You probably forgot that by now, but I'll just tell you. He says, he uses the word confidence twice in that little passage that we just read. We can have confidence. That's a good thing to be confident. Not arrogance in yourself, but confident in what God has given to us. Romans 13:11 tells us this to believers. Wake up! Wake up! Why? Well, the verse says, because your salvation is nearer than when you first believed. You're sitting there thinking, well, I thought I was saved when I first believed. You were saved. You were saved from the penalty of sin, and you were given a home. But you know what? When Jesus Christ returns, our ultimate salvation is going to come to play, and we are going to be saved, delivered from this body, from sin, from death. What a salvation that is. And Paul is saying, wake up. Because that salvation is near. Every day that we're here, we're one day closer to that day. This is great news, people. This is wonderful news. And I just hope that as all of us get closer to the end of this life, that we can have this confidence knowing what our Creator God has provided for us and to us. Through who? Through Jesus Christ, His Son, who died and paid the penalty for our sin. He's resurrected today, and He is coming back someday. He's promised that. This resurrection is a pretty big deal. I'll just take a minute. I was just reading a missionary story about the resurrection, and this was in Colombia, South America. And he's talking to this person. This person says, what? He went through 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the opening verses. He says, well, I knew Christ died for me. Well, I never knew he was resurrected. They never told me that. You mean, you knew that Christ died for you? Oh, yeah. And in this particular case, this guy looked at a crucifix of Jesus hanging on a cross all his life. And he never knew that Jesus isn't on the cross anymore. He never realized that. And when he learned that the resurrection was real, and this guy's article that he was writing was to encourage Christians not to forget the resurrection, not to forget what it means. And by extension, I would say this, pastors, teachers should remind people of what the resurrection means to you, to us. It is our great hope. Let's pause for prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your great love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, you died for us. We thank you for that. But we thank you that your salvation is not just for this life only, but your salvation includes a resurrection so that we someday have something glorious to look forward to, an eternity with our Creator, Jesus Christ, our Savior. We thank you for this. We pray that as we think about this, as we contemplate this, that we'd be motivated to live lives that bring honor and glory to Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, let's stand together and we'll sing, My Jesus, I Love Thee. Thank you for coming, and remember this, we have it on the wall, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Thank you for coming, you're dismissed.